God bless you all, and thank you for the warm greetings from each one of you. It's good to hear from you this morning. So let's get started and let's go to God in prayer. Bless us, Lord, as we worship you and as we wait with great anticipation for you to speak to our hearts this morning. Fill our cups, Lord, until they overflow. Help us hear and learn what you have to say to us today, and give us a mind to apply your word to our lives. Make us sensitive to your Holy Spirit. And I'm asking you, Heavenly Father, right now, to fill me with your Spirit for this task that you've given me today. I'm asking, Lord, that you might move by your Spirit and speak to the hearts of all of the listeners and viewers today, and get the glory out of our lives. I ask this in Jesus' name, amen. The one who loved us and gave himself for us. This morning, my sermon topic is, with the help of the Holy Spirit, how to tear down strongholds. How to tear down strongholds. Today is the first Sunday of our 10 days of fasting and prayer. And as you heard, our theme is pulling down strongholds. So with the help of the Holy Spirit, we will be teaching and preaching on that topic. And I'm going to let the Holy Spirit decide when the teaching will be preaching. We'll move over to preaching, and the preaching will move over to teaching. Hallelujah. Because he is in charge. All right. Now, let me start with reading the verses, the theme verses for today. And those verses are found in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3, 4, and 5. And they read like this. And I'm going to be going between New King James Version and the King James Version. King James Version is fine. All right. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Jesus Christ. It says, you know, though we walk in the flesh, though we live in the flesh, it says our spiritual warfare is not according to the flesh. We're not carrying physical weapons on our warfare, weapons that are according to flesh and using mere human weapons. It says they're not carnal. They're not weapons of flesh and blood. But our weapons are going to be used to pull down, overthrow, and destroy, all right, anything that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bring it into a captivity, every thought to the obedience of Christ. That means anything in through Satan and his kingdom and that warfare, or anything in you and I, in a way that we think, we need to bring it into captivity, all right, to the obedience of Christ. You probably haven't heard very many sermons on this passage of scripture, 2 Corinthians 10, 3 to 5. For most of us, we have not heard very many sermons on the word stronghold, although during our 10 days of fasting and prayer, you'll hear a lot about it, but generally we haven't. Did you know that the word stronghold only appears one time in the New Testament? And the only time it appears is in our text passage today. Now, using the word stronghold as a jumping off point for this message, it could take us in at least three different ways in scripture. The first way, and a lot of this is in the Old Testament, all right? Looking at God as a stronghold for believers, or a fortress, or looking at a stronghold as a fortress or defensive structure. What is a stronghold? As I said before, a defensive structure. Psalm 18:2 says this: "For the Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a what? Stronghold in times of trouble." All right? Amen, amen, amen. All right? He is in a lofty place. He is an inaccessible place to anybody who wants to harm us. He is a defense, a high fort, a tower, a refuge. Praise his holy name. The Lord is my rock, all right? And my fortress, and my deliverer. Psalm 18:2, my God, my strength, in whom I will trust. Okay. Now we're also looking at a stronghold. And let me go back to that. The defensive structure, it puts also in mind Joshua and the city of Jericho. The city of Jericho was a high structure, okay, defensive structure, but God tore that down, didn't he? And they didn't have to do anything for that wall to come down. God did it miraculously. The second way we can look at stronghold is a stronghold as a way to tear down, something to tear down during spiritual warfare, all right? We are in spiritual warfare. I've been telling you this. We've been preaching about this. All right. And we, as believers in Christ, we are on the front lines of warfare. Or the third way we want to look at a stronghold is this: a stronghold in the battlefield of your mind. A stronghold in the battlefield of your mind. All right. And this is a type of stronghold that we will use in our talk about in our message today. Amen. Now, I need to be very clear with you as we go forward. When we're talking about this type of stronghold, we're talking about sins of the thought life, okay, and sins of the heart. And these sins of thought life and the sins of the heart, we usually don't want to try to look at them as sins, but they are. Okay, very clearly spoken of in scripture. All right, let's move on. How to tear down the strongholds. How do we as believers maintain and obtain and maintain a consistent victory in our walk with the Lord? How do we do that? As saints of God, let me tell you what our highest desire should be. And we can find that in Colossians chapter 1, verse 10. Maybe we could put that on the screen. This is a scripture that we should have underlined, and maybe a scripture that we need to put into memory and meditate on. And it says that you and I, may walk worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing him, and being fruitful and every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. That should be our desire, that we might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing him, being fruitful unto every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. That should be our desire. The Lord commands us to live a life of peace and personal holiness. Hebrews 12:14 says, follow peace with all men and holiness, okay, without such no man shall see the Lord. Hebrews 14:5. Strive to live at peace with people and pursue consecration and holiness. However, there may be times when we have problems overcoming sinful attitudes and habits, or times when we don't feel or experience the joy of the Lord of our lives. And we are urged in scripture to watch diligently for those times, that we do not resist the grace of God And when we resist the grace of God, we become defiled. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 15. Hebrews 12, 15. It says, looking diligently, as I was telling you, lest any man fail of the grace of God, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby, by this root of bitterness, many be defiled. We be contaminated. We don't want to be contaminated, children of God. We don't want bitterness to trouble us and cause us torment. The root of bitterness is resentment or hatred. Wow, did you use that word, Bishop? Yes, I did. Yes, I did use it. Pray with me now. Your job is to pray with me as we go through this message, all right, and actively listen. And it's my request that we get this message up on our YouTube station channel very quickly, because I'm going to share a lot of information with you, and you're not going to get it in just one hearing, and that's the hearing now. I'm telling you that. So I'm trusting that this will go up maybe at the beginning of the week so that we can be able to go back and listen to it. All right. Once, okay, or I'm going to give you some definitions in a minute, but as believers, we often overlook the cause of an inconsistent Christian life. And that cause is that we may have given ground, okay, given ground in our soul over to the devil, who has then built strongholds in our lives. We may have given him ground, okay, and then he built strongholds. So the message today, we will focus on this problem and how to regain the ground from the devil and tear them, the strongholds, down in our lives. Some basic facts. Bitterness, greed, or immorality gives Satan ground, okay? It says neither give place to the devil in Ephesians 4:27. Don't give Satan an opportunity to build ground in your life. What's immorality? Lust of the flesh. What's greed? Lust of the eyes. Through the eyes, we see things which our heart begins to covet. And God equates covetousness as idolatry. Bitterness. What is bitterness? The pride of life. Okay? And we're talking about the scripture, 1 John 2:15 through 17. Won't be able to read all these scriptures today, but jot them down. All right? It's talking about love not the world, neither the things of the world. It talks about all that's in the world. It's the lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes. Okay, the pride of life. Bitterness is the pride of life. And let me tell you something. Pride is the root of the sin of bitterness. Did you know that? Pride is the root of the sin of bitterness. And bitterness is a feeling of antagonism or hostility or resentment. And it comes from pride. Satan builds stronghold on his ground. The ground is what you've given up to him. Strongholds are false ideas from which he influences us to make unwise decisions. All right? We've given him ground. He builds a stronghold. Strongholds are false ideas, and he influences us to make false decisions. False ideas lead to wrong actions. When we make wrong decisions, then we do wrong things. And then God allows tormentors, such as fear, depression, anger, lust, anxiety, or even illness, come from the strongholds and afflict other parts of our soul. All right? Think about that. And a lot of these things, again, are sins of the heart. Let me see whether I can make some of this clear, more clear. Follow me. When we talk about these things, I'm going to give you some definitions. Soul, S-O-U-L. That is our minds, our will, and our emotions. Okay? Our mind, our will, and our emotions. Ground. We're going to be talking about ground. What is ground? Ground is a jurisdictional area or place in our souls, all right? Jurisdiction means a territory over which authority extends. Now, God should have authority over all of the ground in our souls. We should have authority over the ground in our souls that we turn over to God. But when we give Satan the ground, he takes the authority over it, all right? Then he builds a stronghold. What is a stronghold? A stronghold is a mindset and conclusions that are contrary to biblical truths. A stronghold of the mind is a lie that Satan has established in our thinking that we count as true, but it's actually a false belief. Did you hear what I said? What is a stronghold? A stronghold of the mind is a lie. We see people acting in the United States right now because of a big lie. Satan can't do anything but tell lies. He's a father of it. A stronghold is in the mind is a lie that Satan has established in our thinking that we count as true, but it's actually false belief. We think something and we act on it as if it's true, all right? When we embrace these lies, what do? They affect our attitudes. They affect our emotions. They affect our behavior, all right? A lot of times we say, we think we know what a person is thinking or why a person is doing what they're doing. Satan tells us that lie. We don't know what a person is doing or what a person is thinking, but we think we do. And because we think we do, we act in ways that are wrong based on that lie. God wants all of his children to walk in victory and freedom in our thought life. He doesn't want us to have our thought life, our soul, tormented by the lies or the strongholds that Satan has built in our souls. What are tormentors? Tormentors are afflictions allowed by God to teach us mercy. When we don't obey and do what God tells us to do what his word tells us to do, he allows these tormentors, these afflictions in our thought life, and sometimes even leading to illness, to teach us mercy and to teach us how to trust God and believe God over the lies of Satan. What is a principality? A principality is the ruler over a jurisdictional area in our lives, okay? A jurisdictional area. That means that God should have control over our souls, all right? But when we give Satan ground, all right, he builds a stronghold, and he is the ruler over that stronghold in our lives. Maybe I can make this more plain to you. Let me use bitterness, which is a sin of the heart, which is a sin of our thought life, all right, as an example. We shared this in our Bible study that we have, but I just want to remind you of some things. All right. Did you know that man is a Trinity? Like being built, made in the image of God, man is a Trinity. What do you mean? Man is a body, soul, and spirit. Amen? Body, soul, and spirit. Through our bodies, okay, we interact with the world around us and people around us, okay? With our soul is our mind, our will, and our emotions, and it's in our thinking, it's our thinking patterns. And in our spirit, we relate to God. Once we're born again, our spirit becomes alive. Before that, we're dead men and women walking. But when we're born again, our spirit becomes alive and we relate to God, all right? Amen. Body, soul, and spirit. So what's the problem? I said we're going to use bitterness as a stronghold. Okay? All right. God commands us in Ephesians 4:31 to put away or get rid of bitterness. Write that down, Ephesians 4:31. There it is. What does it say? Let all bitterness, okay, wrath, anger, and clamor and evil speaking be what? Put away from you with all malice. But right now, we're talking about bitterness. Okay? That's what God tells us. He commands us to do that. All right. Now, thought patterns can become attitudes. And attitudes are habits of the mind. Bitterness can defile our souls. Bitterness is like a sour anger, resentment, and it can lead to hatred. Bitterness reflects a smoldering, like a little fire that's smoldering. It's not out, it's smoldering, okay? Resentment. And bitterness is one of the deceitful faces of pride. Why do I say that? Because bitterness develops in our thought patterns when we feel that we've been unjustifiably hurt and no restitution or apology has been made. So bitterness shows up when we do not want to forgive. Amen? We feel, who do they think they are doing that to me? Don't they know who I am? Who do they think they are? Okay? That's pride, a face of pride. All right? Who do we think we are that we think that we can't be hurt by anybody else? Guess what? Jesus Christ was perfect and he was hurt. Think about that. But that pride sticks up his ugly hand, ugly head. Okay, that's the problem. Bitterness. We didn't get rid of bitterness. We held on to it. It's smoldering in us. All right, what's the consequence? The bitterness decreases our souls, okay? If we pursue that which is evil, God will allow us to have the evil desires of our hearts, and then he will send leanness to our souls. Jot this down, okay? And maybe they could put it up on the screen and you can read it while I'm still sharing a message. Psalm 106, 14 and 15. Leanness decreases the capacity of our souls to respond to God and follow his ways. That's Psalm 106, 14 and 15. Now, what do I mean by that? Okay. Let me read that. But they lusted exceedingly in the wilderness and tempted God in the desert. Next verse. And he gave them their requests, but sent leanness into their souls. That's an example of what we're talking about. All right. Our desire is to hold on to our bitterness, and God then sends leanness to our souls. Think about our souls. Our souls is like a territory. Think about it as a territory of land. All right. Think about it that way. Through bitterness, we surrender an area of our soul to Satan. All right. Think about it as a territory of land. We surrender a part of our soul to Satan. All right? Think about it. All right? Then Satan, because we surrendered it to him, he has a legal right to construct a stronghold on his property. We surrendered it to him, he becomes on his property, that part of our soul. All right? And then he has a right. He has a right to construct a stronghold on it. Remember I said, a stronghold is a way of thinking that is contrary to God's will. All right? God says, get rid of bitterness. Our thinking is, I'm going to hold on to bitterness because I think I've been wrong. Okay? All right. From this stronghold, then, Satan torments us with fear, anger, worry, and other destructive emotions. God tells us in scripture that he would turn us over to tormentors if we do not forgive our offenders. And then if we try to fight the tormentors, Satan will simply retreat to his stronghold because it's his, that part of our soul, and he will wait for another opportunity to attack. And we will never get true freedom until we tear down his stronghold. However, we cannot tear down a stronghold until God reclaims the ground. Think about it. All right, moving on. I know it's a lot. Like I said, I hope this will go on a YouTube channel and we can get in and listen to it again. What's the solution? The solution is good news. Lost ground can be regained. All right, I told you ground is the jurisdictional area of our souls. And Satan is the principality or ruler of that surrendered ground. Surrendered ground brings torment, but ground can be regained one step at a time. I told you again, strongholds are false patterns of thinking. All right? False thinking, I told you, leads to wrong decisions. Wrong decisions lead to wrong actions. Wrong decisions produce destructive emotions such as fear, anger, depression, or worry. Strongholds can be pulled down through the mighty weapons, the spiritual weapons given to us by God. Let me give you an example. I'll give you two of a stronghold. This is what we have in our minds. This is the thought that we made in our mind. Satan put this thought in our mind. And we've had this thought. Many of us have. And this thought is this: my offender will never change. I don't need to forgive him. I don't need to forgive her because they'll never change. Okay? Based upon this false conclusion, Satan, what he does, he convinces husbands and wives to separate and divorce each other. He convinces children to rebel against their parents. Why? Because my offender never changed. I don't like what my parents did to me or how they're treating me. It forces and leads employees to quit their jobs. And guess what? It leads to factions or divisions to begin in churches. Because we have that erroneous thought pattern that whatever happened to me, that pastor, that church leader will never change. So I'm going to do things my way. But that's Satan's lie. What is God's truth? This is what God says. In Jeremiah, put it up, 32:27. This is God's truth. He says, "Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? Anything too hard for me? I'm the Lord God of all flesh." He said, "You say the offender will never change. What about me? I rule and the hearts and minds of people. I can break the rocks and make them change. I can make a hard heart soft. Okay? I can put fire there and burn up everything that's wrong. But you don't trust me. You're believing the Satan's lie." What's another example of Satan's lie, a stronghold he puts on our hearts? This is another lie. "Because of what that person did to me, I'm going to punish my offender. I'm not going to let them get away with it." All right, we used to say when I was going to school, "Okay, you did that to me. Paybacks are hard. I just want you to know your day is coming. All right, I'll punish my offender." God promises to punish our offender if he continues to reject the gracious appeals of those he offends. It is not our place to bring retaliation, but allow the wrath of God to take its course. Romans 12:19 speaks to that. It says, "Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place to wrath, for it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord.'" That's God's truth. Satan's stronghold in his lie is, it's on me to punish my offender. Okay. Tormentors are powers of evil to afflict our souls. The root word means to produce anguish and vexation. God sends tormentors to bitter people. A bitter person becomes a prisoner of his own making. He is angry. He or she is depressed, they're disillusioned. They're unable to concentrate on their responsibilities or enjoy the relationships that God has designed for him to have. Tormentors are sent to teach the meaning of mercy and forgiveness. All right. Matthew 18:34-35. This is out of the parable that Jesus taught on forgiveness. I wanted to skip over it because time is running out, but I think it's important for us to read it. Matthew 18:34. This is at the end of it. When this man who was forgiven by his Lord, but would not forgive a man who offended him, And it says his Lord was wroth, angry, and delivered him to what? The tormentors, till he should pay all that was due unto him. Verse 35. Listen, this is Jesus speaking. It says, so likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if from your hearts, if ye from your hearts forgive not everyone his brother their trespasses. I did not say this. Jesus said it. All right. I'm going to give you 6 steps, and I'm going to go through it really quick. Please get this on our YouTube station. Steps to regain ground. How do we get it back? First, confess each sin of bitterness that God brings to your mind. 1 John 1:9 says, put it up. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. I want you to know 1 John 1:9 was written to believers. All right. And guess what? We must name our sins by the terms God calls them. Not just saying, well, I was just upset. That's why I'm acting this way. That's why I don't forgive, because I was just upset. Liar, pants on fire. All right. Use the word. God says it's the sin of bitterness. So we have to go to God and say, Lord, forgive me of the sin of bitterness. And then also go back to the appropriate people who have been directly affected by your sin and ask for their forgiveness too. 2, claim the blood of Jesus Christ for cleansing. It says he will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 Peter, put it up there, chapter 1, verses 18 and 19. All right? 1 Peter 1:18-19. Verse 18. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things as silver and gold from your vain conversations received by the tradition of your fathers, but by the precious blood of Christ as a lamb without blemish or spot. All right? So what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to reject Satan's claim on the ground of our souls and say to Satan, I belong to Jesus Christ. You have no right to have that ground in my soul. You have no right. I do not belong to you. And then we need to ask God to take over that authority and take back that ground. All right? Ask God to take over that authority, take over that ground. 3. Okay, ask God and say this out loud to regain the ground. Psalm 23:3. We read this and we never think about this in this context. Psalm 23:3. It says, he restoreth my soul and leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. 4, tear down the strongholds with truth. And that was 2 Corinthians 10:3-5. We read that. All right. It talks about though we walk in the flesh, we do not live according to the flesh. Okay. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, through the pulling down of strongholds, casting down all imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself. Remember 2 things. The battle is in our minds. Okay. And it's not fought according to the way the world fights. Our weapons are not physical, but spiritual, but mighty in nature. 5, transform your mind with truth. Romans 12:2. Put this up if you can. Romans 12:2. And it says, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Once we have made wrong decisions and violated God's law, it's easier to fall back into that same sin of bitterness again. So to guard off against this, we have to set up daily disciplines like making commitments and like to higher standards and say, I'm not going to go that way anymore. And the last way that we forgive, that we tear down the stronghold, is 6. And it says, fully forgive our offender. Fully forgive our offender. Fully forgive our offender. Let's look at Jesus' words again. St. Matthew chapter 6, verses 14 and 15. And this is in his model prayer. And he says, "For if ye forgive men their trespasses, your Father, Heavenly Father, will also forgive you. But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." So we're talking about how to tear down strongholds. I gave you 6 steps to take. We have work to do, Church of God. Jesus is coming soon. And I want to say to you, as I close, love our God, trust our God, worship and serve our God, and fight the good fight of faith. Let's tear down those strongholds in our lives. Amen, amen, amen. Enjoy your day of worship.